Praise the Lord. Amen. We're glad to be in the house of God tonight. Thank you to those that are joining us in-house. We also appreciate those that are joining us on our live feed. If you're on our live feed, I want to welcome you to the Coosa Valley Church of God here in Cropwell, Alabama. If you're joining us on our Facebook page, be sure to click like. Also comment and share onto your feed. We'd love for you to help us to spread the gospel. If you're on our YouTube channel, please make sure you're clicking subscribe. If you've not already clicked subscribe, go to the YouTube channel and just search for Coosa Valley Church of God and subscribe, and then also click the little bell so that you can receive notifications for when we do go live. Also, you can visit our website. Website is on your screen for more information about the church, how to connect, and so much more. We've got a lot that we need to be praying for. There's several prayer requests connected with our church. We've had some sickness, non-COVID related, but we've had some sickness connected with our church. We've had some churches in our area that has had some positive COVID tests. We've had several in our church that's been tested. They've come back negative. I know that the time's coming we're going to have, but you know what? The thing is, as I was talking to someone the other day, I know that there's a sickness, and I fully agree with that, and I know that it's there. But I also serve a highly big prayer-answering God, and I know that He's able to keep me, and even in this day, amen? I didn't say anybody need to go around and start licking doorknobs, but we need to really watch what we're doing, and we need to really do what we need to do to keep ourselves safe. But we also need to worship and praise God. Amen. And that's what we've come here to do tonight. So if you have a prayer request on our live feed, you can text it to the number on your screen or visit our website and submit that. If you're in-house, if you've got a prayer request, let it be known by lifting your hands. God knows each one. Let's all stand, those that can. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask God to move and minister this very afternoon. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to you again today, I want to thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity that you've allowed us to come to worship and praise you. And Father, I pray right now that you'll just continue to move and minister in a mighty way this very day, this very hour. Open the windows of heaven and pour out an anointing and a blessing upon this service. Those that are joining us in-house, those that are joining us on live feed, Father, I pray that you'll just move in a mighty way today. And I pray, Father, that something is said, something is done to bring an encouragement. Father, right now I'm praying for our discipleship kids class. I pray for our Ignite student ministries. Father, I pray for guidance and direction, wisdom and understanding in all areas. Father, I pray that you'll help us to reach somebody to be able to proclaim the good news of who your Son is. And Father, I thank you for that, and I praise you for it. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Would you give God a hand clap of praise and let's worship this evening? Amen.
The Lord of Gears.
wants to pray. You know, I had somebody to tell me one time, said, you know, even as an older minister, and he said, even when things are just going wrong, things are just turning upside down, if you just say the name of Jesus, it just seems like that just a sweet presence just covers over and everything just seems so much better just by saying the name of Jesus. I'm so glad that we have that ability. Amen. Glory be to God. Amen. If you're right, wherever you may be, would you just give God a hand clap of praise this evening? Amen. I'm so glad that God is a prayer answering God. Amen. Glory be to God. Amen. Again, we greatly appreciate you being with us this evening as we're transitioning to a time of Bible study. I want to thank those that have utilized our online giving. Thank you to those that have mailed in your contributions or brought them to the church. We've got a drop box still on the outside. We have our mailbox at the house. If you mail it to the church, excuse me, and it will go there. You can utilize our online giving. God is going to continue to be blessing. Amen. And we do pray over that all of the time, that God's going to bless those that gives. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And I'm so thankful for your giving. Amen. To find out more information about our online giving, you can just visit our website that's on your screen, and you'll find out more information. Click on the Give button, and God will certainly bless you. Amen. If you have your Bibles, we're going to be looking and continuing as we've been looking over the last couple of Wednesday nights in the book of Nehemiah. We're looking in the book of Nehemiah chapter 8. So if you have your Bibles, if you will, go ahead and turn with us there into chapter 8. Brother Andy, you talked about chapter 8 last Wednesday. Yep. most of our church folks already realize I like digging into things and I like looking at things. And so we're still in chapter 8. I don't know that I've ever been able to get through a full outline in one service sitting. So although I did preach on Jesus wept one time and the smallest verse in the Bible, and I might have gotten through. I don't remember. But anyway, we want to take a look here at Nehemiah chapter 8. This evening I want to read the very first verse one more time. And then as we're looking through tonight, there'll be other verses I will refer to, but we're going to just read chapter 8, verse 1. We're just going to read that, and we're going to be looking again at Nehemiah chapter 8, verses 1 through 18 one more time this evening. Chapter 8, verse 1 tells us this. This is what it says. It says, "And all the people gathered as one man into the square before the water gate. And they told Ezra the scribe." Now remember, this is Nehemiah. Nehemiah is leading the people. And he calls to the pastor of the church. He calls to the priest. He calls to the scribe. He calls to the one that's got the scrolls. And he calls him and brings him in. And they tell Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, the word of God, that the Lord had commanded Israel. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, again as we come to you today, we want to thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you again for this wonderful opportunity that you've allowed us to come to worship and praise you. And Father, for the next few moments as we're taking a look at your word, Father, I pray that you'll continuously hide us behind the cross of Calvary, that those looking would see your Son being high and lift it up, that all would be drawn unto you. We forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Again, Nehemiah chapter 8 and verse, we're looking at chapter 8, verses 1 through 18, but there's a couple of things that I wanted to read. This has been one of our little study books that we have looked at, and we had someone that's been helping me speak some on Wednesday nights. I'm not going to say who she is. But I did find out that I'm bringing her out of her comfort zone, and I just want her to understand me too. I love doing studies like this. This is not my strong suit, but I love studies like this, but I just, it's hard for me to stay on a study. Does that surprise anybody? It's very, very hard for me to stay on a study like this, something like this. But I want us to take a look at something tonight, and I think that this the book of Nehemiah written at least 2 or 3 years ago, and then this little study that's here that we've been looking at, copyright in 2001, is written, in other words, this has all been written before the time that we're living in right now. It says before where we're at in the year 2020. And I want to read a passage, I want to read a paragraph out of this little study. Those that's in our church family, if you want a copy of this, there's still some out in the foyer when you come on the little bookcases there, so you can take a look at that. But I want us to look at this. This is a paragraph here, and as this starts off, and it says, the first reaction of people when they hear the book of the law is usually to mourn and to weep. Both mourning and weeping are typical signs of repentance when God's word is being read. Why is that so important? The Word of God, and we've mentioned this over the last couple of services, the Word of God was not written, and I know that some people, this shocks them, but the Word of God was not written for the unchurched. The Word of God is written for those in the church house to know how we're supposed to live our lives, how we're supposed to conduct ourselves in things such as businesses and finances and fundraising. Hallelujah, glory to God. And it also somebody told me that everything's not in the Bible. I said, oh, yes, it is. And they said, well, find me a sermon on fundraising. Give me 30 minutes. And I got it. They didn't think it was in there. Guess what? I had them a sermon in 30 minutes. I've not found any topic yet that's not in the Bible. And it's just instructions for God's children in order to live our lives like we're supposed to. How to conduct ourselves. How to turn from sin. Notice that the Scripture does not say in a very famous passage of Scripture that maybe nobody in this church has ever heard of. If you haven't, you haven't been listening. But 2 Corinthians 7:14, if my people, notice that's several times in the Word of God. That's what it says, is if my people. He's talking to his church. But Brother Andy, is not the Word of God not supposed to be for the lost? Is it not supposed? Did Jesus not come to save the lost? Absolutely. But the Word of God is written to show us how to be the witnesses in a lost and dying world. We are the Bible that they read. And that is a lot of what's going on today. And so so with that, especially right now more than ever before, I've had people even this week to call me. Even this week to call me, and they'll not going to Coosa Valley. They go to other churches or may not even go to church, some of them. And they'll call me, Brother Chuck, and they'll say, is what's going on right now in the world we're living in, is this an indication of something biblical proportion fixing to happen? One of them I started to say, look, quit beating around the bush. You want to know if this is time for the rapture. I mean, that's what they're asking. And I'm going to tell you something. I would say absolutely. Now, if the rapture don't take place for another 100 years, guess what? It's getting closer now than it's ever been before. Amen? And that's what we've got to understand today. We've got to understand that the rapture of the church is taking place sooner rather than later. Now, knowing that, when reading the Word of God, look at what else is said here. Look at this. It said the first reaction of the people when they hear the book of the law, the Word of God, to be read, is weeping and mourning. Weeping and mourning are typical signs of repentance when the Word of God is being read. While certainly repentance would come for God's people, they are encouraged
at this time and where we're looking at right now in Nehemiah, not to weep, but to eat, drink, and be joyful. Why? Because the city of God has been restored. God's word is being read to His people one more time. They could live in obedience and live in a blessful life. Why? Because that gave them great cause to celebrate. Why? Because the word of God is being fulfilled right before their eyes. You know, the thing is that's what we've got to look at today. We've got to look at our time today, and we can see the word of God is being fulfilled right before our very eyes. It's being fulfilled. And what we've got to notice is simply this. As the word of God is being fulfilled, yes, this is a time of sorrow. This is a time of weeping for the things that's going on. But I also know there's a passage of scripture that says something along the lines of this. It says, look up, your redemption draws nigh. I know that things are going on right here. Things are going on all around us. But I'm just going to keep my eyes focused on the eastern skies because I know something of a biblical proportion is about to take place. Nehemiah knew that right here in this passage of Scripture. He knew that something of a biblical proportion had just taken place. The city has been restored. So Ezra has been called and he's been brought in to assemble. They assembled in a large public square. Ezra led the worship service. He was the priest and the scribe. He had studied the word of God. And throughout this, there were 13 Sunday school teachers in our language that was scattered throughout the crowd. Now, how big was this crowd? This crowd, according to the census of the time, the crowd was large, 50 plus thousand easily. And there was the pastor of that time, Ezra. He's the priest and the scribe. He is up and he is teaching the word of God. He's reading the word of God. And there were 13 Sunday school teachers scattered all throughout these thousands of people. And every time something was said, what did he mean by that? Then these Sunday school, I'm calling them Sunday school teachers. The Bible didn't call them that. But I'm breaking this down for our time frame today. They would go around and they was explaining. Now over the last couple of days, I've said a word. And the group of people that I was around, one of the guys looked at me and he said, are you talking about chocolate? I said the word caveat. He said, I ain't got a clue what you're talking about. Are you talking about expensive chocolate? I said, absolutely not. But I'll eat some expensive chocolate if you want me to. So when a word like caveat was mentioned, if he's watching, I'm going to be in trouble. He'll probably text me in a minute. Whenever a word or something was said that needed to be explained, what did they do? These Sunday school teachers was going around amongst the crowd, and then they would gather together and they would explain what was said. And then Ezra would continue on. Is that making sense? I'm laying a visual description. We didn't get to this last week. I'm laying a visual description about what's going on. So let's look. Ezra is here and he's bringing this out and he's showing everything. Throughout the verses that are being read in our passages of Scripture here, throughout these verses, the focus is simply this. I want you to catch this. The focus of these 18 verses is that the people was to understand the Word of God. Now look. Not that I can pronunciate any of these long, drawn-out words. but in a college education that I might not have gotten. They use all these big, long words. And I hear people preach and I hear people teach today. And I'll hear them and they'll start saying words. I may not can pronounce a lot of words, but I understand a lot of words. I may not can spell half of what I can understand, but I can understand some of these big, long words. I definitely can't spell them because they're more than four or five letters. But I know what the word means. Why? Because I've heard them before. And one of my favorite books next to the Bible is a Webster's Dictionary. Glory to God. And if I don't understand the word, I'll open that dictionary up and I find it. Now they got this great and wonderful invention called Google Speak. The problem is, Brother Art, I can't speak them, so it don't understand me. Somebody's asked me if I use talk to text all the time. Nope. It don't understand what I'm saying. But so I look through and I'll catch words a lot of times. But look, if we're teaching and we're preaching and people are not understanding the words of the Word of God because we're trying to speak way up here, then that's not doing anybody any good. We've got to speak on everybody's level, and this is what's going on. And there was those Sunday school teachers that was floating around amongst the crowd and fully teaching more of the Word of God. The main point is the people was to understand the Word of God. Why? Because there was a deep hunger for more of God. We need folks with a deep hunger of God today. Amen? Let's go on and look at this. Take a look. There are certain things I want to bring out about Ezra's teachings. First of all, Ezra read the Word of God for about 6 hours. We would be in trouble today. We have a hard enough time getting people to stay awake for an hour being in church or to be here for an hour. He was reading the Word of God for 6 hours. What did he read? Since it would be impossible to read all five books of the books of Moses within 6 hours, he read and explained certain portions of the law. Imagine the hunger that has gripped the hearts of the children of God that they actually stood or sat for 6 hours while somebody read and taught the Word of God. We have nice, comfortable pews. Some churches have nice, comfortable chairs. And we've got a hard time getting people. Now, I know that we've got a hard time right now getting. Well, I don't know that we want our. I want the facilities full. I don't misunderstand what I'm saying. But we've got to be very mindful right now in that. So when I say I want the facilities full, don't think that I'm being callous of what's going on. I'm not saying that. Every one of us should want the church houses full. Amen. I want the church houses full of people that are hungry for the Word of God. I said this one time before, and I had a bunch of great saints of God get very mad at me. I would rather have a house full of sinners or brand new Christians that are wanting more of God than a house full of seasoned saints. And I have people that gets mad at me every time I say that. So if you're one of those, go ahead, get mad, I don't care. You explain you why. If I've got a house full of sinners or brand new Christians that's wanting more of God, then that means that the seasoned saints have gone out into the highways and byways and bid folks to come in. And the seasoned saints need to be floating around like the Sunday school teachers and teaching more of the Word of God. I'm supposed to be teaching. Hang on, let me get back over here. We've got to have people that are hungry for God. Ezra read the Word of God and we mentioned this last Wednesday night. He read the Word of God to all the people who were old enough to understand. Now, tonight we've got some of our kids, they're back they're in the children's church class, and we've got some students in the Ignite Student Ministries, and this is not a Bible, this is not a babysitting service time. Sure, there's games being played, and there's lessons, but there's also lessons being taught. There's also instructions from the Word of God being given. Amen? And that's what we've got to have. I don't like it. I've been in churches before, and I walk through, and it's nothing but pop a VeggieTale movie, and I'm not trying to knock VeggieTales. Don't anybody throw something at me. Because, yes, my daughter loved VeggieTales. She still loves VeggieTales. My daughter loved VeggieTales when she was a baby, okay? But I know it, but I like a Mater sandwich. I don't like Bob sitting around there bopping around on a TV screen. But he makes me want to eat a Mater sandwich. But the thing about it is, yes, they're teaching the Bible, and I get that. And that's great and wonderful, but we need to dig more into the Word of God. We don't need to have a time just a babysitting service time, but we need a time, young and old alike, of teaching the Word of God. Why? How does this happen? We need people that are hungry for God. And I'm going to tell y'all something. I know I've done lost count. If I say 12 weeks, y'all know that. I mean 12 plus weeks, whatever we're at now. That is one thing that I think that COVID, one of the greatest things that has come out of this coronavirus, is that there are more people that are hungry for the Word of God than there ever have been before. Why? Because now you can see Bible teaching, you can see preaching all over social media. You can't flip it around without seeing somebody somewhere teaching and preaching the Word of God. And people are getting hungry for more of God. So that's something that has come out of this. God's Word being taught to people that were old enough to understand, old enough to grasp the meaning of the Word of God. The emphasis here is, they were attentive. Now, of all people, does everybody know? Okay, live feed, I can't see your comments, so if you're making comments about this, I'll read them later, and y'all have to go back and see my responses to you later. But does everybody understand what I mean by a squirrel moment? Uh-huh. Do you know who has the worst time about a squirrel moment than anybody else? If I'm standing right here where I'm standing at, I can see that stop sign right down the road if I look just the right way. And I see people on Sunday mornings, if I happen to glance right over this direction, I see people fly through that thing and almost wreck. On Sunday mornings when we're sitting here. And I promise you, if there's a wreck sometime right down at the intersection, right up the road, it's going to catch my attention. It's not that I'm not attentive to this, but I have got undiagnosed attention deficit disorder. Anything, a bouncy ball will catch my attention and I'm gone. Okay? Our cat laying in the living room, sound asleep. A bouncy ball bounced across that kitchen floor. That cat is on it like Donkey Kong. You'd think that cat was nowhere in the world, but all of a sudden, bam, that cat's on it. Until that cat's tired and gonna move on to something else. That's me. I can bounce on something so quick and then I'm done with it and I'll move on to something else. But these people that Ezra was reading to, as we've read out of verse 1, the Word of God tells us in several passages, tells us that these folks, they were attentive. They were attentive. They didn't have an intersection right up the road that they was watching and seeing if there was a wreck. Now, I'm not constantly watching that intersection, but if there's a wreck, it's going to catch me out of the corner of my eye. But they was attentive to what the Word of God was being taught, what was being said, what was being produced by the man of God that was preaching and by those that was there teaching the Word of God. They was attentive and they wasn't worried about the pot roast at the house. They was attentive to the Word of God. Let's move on and look at something else. Ezra was reading. Verse 4 tells us that Ezra was reading from a high wooden platform that had been built for this such a special occasion. Surrounding was the 13 assistants, six standing on his right-hand side and seven standing on his left-hand side. These were some of the influential lay leaders among the Jewish people. When Ezra opened the scrolls, all of the people, verse 5, immediately arose and they stood in reverence to the Word of God being read. The holy law of God, the Word of God. The multitude that knew that they would not be listening to just the words of a man, but they would be hearing the very Word of God Himself. The Lord deserved to be reverenced, honored, and given holiness to that. Now, I want you to hear what I'm fixing to say. There are so many today that has lost the reverence for the things of God. I'm not talking about just His Word. Now, this building is just a building. This is sheetrock. There's electrical wires, and I promise you there is sound system wires. I have seen wires. There are wired in places that you wouldn't think they was wires. I heard somebody say amen, and I ain't got my glasses on, so I don't know who said it. But there are wires hanging from the ceiling, and there's wires in the walls. There's wires running this way, and there's wires running under your feet. There's carpet laid down over a concrete slab. There's pews in here. There's light fixtures hanging from the ceiling. There's paint on this sheetrock. This is a building. But some 18 years ago, some 18 plus years ago, this building, and did you know, let me, before I go there, y'all know, already know where I'm going, but before I go there, did you know that under this carpet, under that carpet in the sound booth, under this carpet on the stage, there's Bible scriptures wrote all throughout. Behind this sheetrock, on some of the 2x4s, I've been told there's script. I ain't seen them because the sheetrock's up. But I've been told there's scriptures that's wrote all over this place. I wish somebody would tell me what Bible verse was wrote right there. Because I'm going to tell you something. Every time I stand right there, I feel like fire going up my legs. But there's Bible scriptures that's been wrote all over this place. But some 18 plus years ago, this building was not dedicated to indoor boat storage. This building was not dedicated to selling products, but this building was dedicated to the reverence of the Holy One, God Almighty. This building was dedicated to the worship of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. This building was dedicated. A cross was put up here, and I've put another cross over there because I use it sometimes in preaching. This building was dedicated for the Holy Spirit of God to maneuver around His people and to influence lives. This building was dedicated for lives to be changed, not for people to come and leave the same way. This building has been dedicated to God. So in that, it's not showing reverence to sheetrock or electrical wiring. It's showing reverence to the one that it was dedicated to. This right here, I get people mad at me every time I do this, and that's all right, because they get glad soon quick. This right here is a bonded leather, a premium bonded leather book. It has pages right here in the middle of it. It has is very thin sheets of paper. And on those sheets of paper, they got black and they got red ink. It was bonded and put together, and it was shipped out into stores, just books just like this, all across this nation and around this world. This right here ain't nothing but leather and pieces of paper, wood been made into paper, ink put on those paper. That's all this is. But what's on those paper? The words that was put on those sheets of paper. This book right here has more to it than this book right here. This book right here, and I need another hand. This book right here and this book right here was printed in the same fashion. This book right here and this book right here was shipped and sold in like same fashion. But there's one thing about this book right here that is over this book. It doesn't matter what this book is. But there's one thing about this book. This book has been dedicated to spread the good news about a man that came down from heaven and lived among mankind. This book right here has been sent, dedicated to a man that walked around and is like infirmities, just like we've gone through. This was dedicated to a man that walked around and has faced the same trials and tribulations that we would face. This book right here tells of exploits of things that he's done. It tells of things that he's done in the name of his heavenly Father. This book right here tells about a man by the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. This book right here tells about the Holy Spirit of God, how that he ascended down from heaven and then went into an upper room. My Lord, have mercy. This book right here tells about a story about a man by the name of John, that he was on an island one day, left for dead, and how the visions that, my dear Heavenly Father, I better just get back over here and go on somewhere. This book right here was dedicated, but there are so many that has lost the reverence for this book and for this place. There's people that has lost the reverence for the men and women that have dedicated their lives to spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. Oh, there's nothing about somebody that has dedicated their lives. Oh, the Bible tells us this: blessed. Woo! Somebody turn that clock upside down. It says, blessed are the feet. Let me just go ahead and share with y'all something. My feet, they don't smell too good. My feet, they may not look very good. But I want you to understand something right here real quick, like, if my feet are blessed because I carry the good news of Jesus Christ, imagine what my God in heaven, imagine the rest of us. My Lord, have mercy. But the Bible tells us, so I'm telling you that to tell you this. There was reverence. People want to know why God don't move today like He used to move. Well, I'm going to tell you something. If God's seen a bunch of folks standing around for 6 hours, standing and listening with great attentiveness to hear the Word of God, if God's seen people that showed reverence to the house of God, to His Word, and to the people delivering the Word of God, I think God might just say, I'm going to open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing and an anointing that they've never felt before. People ask me all the time, have you ever seen a miracle? Have people ask me that? I've had people recently ask me that. Yep. I've seen them. I'm going to tell you something. I love it when God does miracles and mighty wonders amongst our presence. Amen? I love it when God moves in mighty ways. Why does God not move? I don't know where you've been at. I've seen God move. I feel the presence of God. When I come into His house and into His presence, I feel Him. When I'm sitting in my office by myself, I feel the presence of God. Let's go on. Before Ezra began to read and teach the word, verse 6, look at that. Verse 6 tells us that before Ezra began to teach the Word of God, he took a moment to gripe, complain, and grumble. Now, wait a minute, my glasses need fixing. Because that's not what he did in verse 6. He took a moment to give God praise. In response, the children of God that was... Could y'all just imagine? Could y'all imagine this? Now, I have stood here in this sanctuary. Now, I know over the last several months that we've had very limited number of people inside of our sanctuary. We've had a very limited number. But I have stood here on several different occasions, and we would have a lot of folk in this house. And I have stood here like I've done before every service. Somebody asked me one time, said, why do you say the same prayer? And why do you open services the same way? Because I'm trying to teach our children how to worship God. I love it when I get a text message from a mom and dad, and they'll tell me, well, my child just closed the service out in prayer, and he said your prayer word for word. I love those times. We'll have times when our teenagers are sitting throughout the sanctuary, and as I'm dismissing, I'm closing the service out in prayer, and I'm dismissing in prayer, and I'll scan across, and I'll see a lot of our teenagers, and they're mouthing the prayer. They know exactly the words I'm fixing to say. You know what? They don't realize it. Train up a... Oh, no. Nobody got that. But watch this. When Ezra began to read, he took a moment to praise the Lord. In response, could you just imagine this? Could you imagine 50,000 people sitting in that arena? Now, I know that there have been... I know that we've had events in our nation that there's been that many people in an arena, and they have cheered and they've clapped, And I've seen it on TV where they'll start hollering, USA, USA, USA. And you know what? The American in me, that makes me very proud. I like seeing that. And I know that there are a lot of people that they say that what I just said wasn't politically correct, and I really don't care. You know what? Because I got the microphone. They go around, and I'll sit there, and I'll watch them, and they'll say, USA, USA, USA. But you know what makes me more proud? When I'll stand up here on a Sunday morning, I don't care if there's about half of our congregation like we've had over the last several Sunday mornings, or if we couldn't put another person in here like we've had sometimes before. And I'll have everybody to stand, and we'll pray, and I'll say, would you just take a moment, and would you give God the greatest hand clap of praise that you can give Him? And everybody will start clapping their hands, and I'll hear somebody say, amen. I'll hear somebody else say, praise the Lord. I'll hear somebody say, hallelujah. That makes me feel more excited than USA, USA, USA. Now, could you just, I'm closing, I promise. Could you just imagine standing there in Ezra's shoes, standing there on that mountain, on that hillside, standing behind that wooden platform that had been built for this time? He was standing there with his sandals there, and he's standing behind that, and he's fixing to read the scripture. He's fixing to just read the scripture. Now, he might have been going to read that day about everybody who begot somebody. That's in there. This one begot this one, and this one begot this one, and this one begot this one. And somebody asked me, said, do you really read a lot of that? I said, yep. Let me tell you something. And I'm not trying to be ugly, and I'm not trying to be funny on this, but I want to tell you something. If you can't sleep, read the begots for a minute, you'll be sound asleep. Now, Brother Andy, those names mean something. They sure do. They mean a whole lot. But I promise you, it will help you go to sleep. Now, I'm not trying to be ugly when I say that. I know somebody will probably say something, but I'm going to tell you something. Does it every time. But could you just imagine, today's the day that Ezra is going to read all the begots. But before he starts, he just says, congregation, all 50,000 of you. Boy, I'm going to tell you something. If I stood here standing before 50,000 people and they started, we wouldn't have church for a little while because y'all couldn't find me. We're fixing to read in Genesis about everybody that begot somebody. But before we do, I want y'all to give God some praise. And all of a sudden, there's a hand clap goes across that cavern, and people are starting to say, amen, glory to God, hallelujah. Boy, wouldn't that be some excitement going on? These two acts, Ezra giving God praise and the congregation giving God praise, indicate that the people affirm and agree with what Ezra's fixing to read. They bow down and worship the Lord. Last thing I want to talk about these 13 Levites one more time. These 13 Sunday school teachers, I want to wrap them down, and then we'll move on. We're going to close right here. Ezra had the 13 Levites, 6 on one hand and a 7 on the other hand, to help him explain the Word of God. This is in verse 7 and 8. This was necessary because the language differences and the translation that was needed in some cases. Now, I want to bring out about the translation differences. Now, I realize that today we have got so many translations of the Bible. I'll have people come to me and they'll say, well, which translation do I need to read? Which translation do I need to read? Well, at first glance, I'm going to tell you, read which one is comfortable for your reading level. Okay, that's the first thing I'm going to say. Why? Because I'm just glad that the Word of God's going in you. If the words the Word of God is going in you, we can teach about that. We can teach from that. Oh, but Brother Andy, they don't need to read XYZ translation. I really don't care if they're reading that translation or not. I am glad that the Word of God is going into their lives. Amen? We need the Word of God being poured in. Because if junk's being poured in, junk's going out. But if the Word of God's going in, at least God can make a change in somebody's life. Amen? Then people will ask me, well, which translation is closest to the original script? I've got a chart for that. I can show you a chart of where things are laid out at. So I know that it'll upset somebody, but the King James Version is not the closest to the original translation. Somebody just got mad at me and called me a heretic. I know they did. I love the King James Version. But people are wanting something that's going all the way back to the original. I tell them to read the translation that's closest to what you're comfortable to read. Because if you're reading this, that, these, and those, and you're not understanding it, then all you're doing is getting frustrated. But if you can read another version of the Bible, and you can feel comfortable, and it's going in, and you're going to get hungry for more, then eventually God's going to start showing you more and more things from the Scripture. Now, let's take a look at these Levites again. These Levites was walking around, and because of a learning gap, and because of a translation gap, and because of a language gap, some of these people had lived in captivity in Babylon most of their lives. As a result, they did not understand Hebrew. So the 13 Levites stationed throughout the crowd, as things arose, they would explain the Scripture being read and answer the questions that the people had based on census figures of the day. The crowd was massive. Up to 50,000 people were there. It was very necessary to have people scattered to explain the meaning of the Scripture. This right here is why I firmly believe. Now, I know right now we're not having in-house Sunday school. I know that right now we're not having in-house several things. But this right here is the prime reason why I firmly believe in Sunday school. This is a prime reason why I firmly believe in Bible study times. Why? Because even on Wednesday nights, I know that I get to preaching sometimes, but this is still a wonderful time to take our time and break the Word of God down into segments that we're easily able to digest. Here's an example. If I gave, of the people that's in here, I know that everybody in here, most everybody in here, I'll say it, loves a good steak. Somebody just went, And each one has got a different way that they like it cooked. One may like it rare. Some likes it burnt. And some likes it in the middle. And all points in between. Some likes it with A1 steak sauce. Some likes it with no steak sauce. Some likes it with seasoning, and some likes it with a lot, and some likes it with none. All differences, but there's one thing about it. Every one of us likes it in bite-sized portions. There's no way that you can eat a steak in one bite. You've got to break it down in bite-sized portions. That's the same thing it is with the Word of God. There's so many times people want to take the whole Word of God and try to digest it in one sitting. You'll never be able to do it. There's still scriptures that's been opening up in my mind that I've read that scripture a dozen times and never seen that before. The Word of God's going to open in our minds. God is wanting to use right now in the life that we're living. God is wanting to use us and use right now to open His Word in ways He's never opened it before. We've just got to be willing to open our eyes and allow Him to do it. Amen? Let's bow our heads and let's pray this evening. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, again as we come to you today, I want to thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity that you've allowed us to come to worship, praise, and magnify you. Father, this evening as we have brought forth your word, as you've given it to us, I pray, Father, that your word will go forth and will touch the hearts and lives, bring encouragement where is needed. And Father, I thank you for that and I praise you for it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Those that are joining us on live feed, appreciate you being a part of our services this evening. On your screen, you'll see a way that you can text and call in your prayer requests or submit them online at the web address on your screen. Thank you for being a part of the great part of Coosa Valley, joining us with us. Join back with us on Sunday school Sunday morning at 9:45, worship at 11, Sunday night at 5 o'clock. May the good Lord bless you is our prayer. Amen and amen. Amen. Again, I greatly appreciate y'all being in the house tonight. We're off.
To your heart, you keep drawing me, you keep drawing me closer to your heart, you keep calling me, you keep calling me closer to step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow. Together wonderful to me.
music fades, dawn is stripped away, and I simply come home,
longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart.
Lost its sting.